Well, there is plenty more to unpack this morning on jabs for kids, vaccine boosters and the current threat from Omicron. We're joined now by infectious diseases expert Professor Peter Collignon in Canberra. Professor, good morning to you. Let's start, if we can, with Pfizer for kids. What difference will this make going into the new school year?
Well, we do now seem to have enough data to show that in children, the vaccine will be safe and effective. Children have much less complications and still actually relative to their parents who are, if they're unvaccinated, much less infection. But they do get infection and they can be a way that it can spread to others. So vaccinating them gives them protection, but also decreases the chance or the amount of infections they'll get and then pass on to others. So it will make a difference, and it should make a lot of difference so that we don't have classes being closed, schools being closed next year. We've had a lot of loss of school, some more than we need, where, you know, whole schools are being closed, etc. But we don't have zero COVID anymore as a policy, and that actually means we can have much more normal schooling, particularly after children are vaccinated in reasonable numbers.
Okay, we will be one of the first countries to do this in the world. So what would you say to any parents who are still sitting on the fence?
Well, I don't think we're the first people in the world. There's been millions of children already in the US that have been vaccinated with this reduced dose that's in the Pfizer vaccine. And the good news is the original studies were relatively small, only a few thousand, but there's now been millions of children vaccinated in the US. And if you get complications, you usually get them within a week or two. So I think it's very good that we've got data in effect on millions of children, and it's been shown that these any rare side effects seem to be very uncommon, less common than teenagers, interestingly, which is good news. We need more data as time goes on, but so far it's looking good without any unexpected side effects occurring rarely in, say, 1 in 100,000 children that's really serious, etc.
Yeah, the data is reassuring, isn't it? On booster shots, Peter, Omicron has forced the UK to accelerate its rollout. Should we be following their lead and bringing that third shot forward?
Well, I think we need to be careful about that. The data does show that if you have a third shot, you get longer or better protection than if you only have two shots. But you've got to remember, in the countries where all this data comes from, it's mainly people who've already had their first and second shot 6 months earlier. All the available data is that up to 6 months, you get a 90% reduction in the your risk of hospitalisation and probably 95% reduction in your risk of death if you get infected. So, yes, we do have a lot of people that need to get their boosters. Probably most people over the age of 60 were vaccinated more than 6 months ago and they need to get their booster shot. But we need to be careful about not rushing it for everyone else. Because what we saw in England, for instance, and even here, but particularly in England, when they had a shortage of vaccine and delayed the first and second dose, they got better protection than if they just gave it a month apart. And it's the same with booster shots. One vaccine that we've got a third shot for, called hepatitis B, it's very important you get it around 6 months after your first shot because it gives you then immunity that lasts for decades. So if we rush it too early, we may lose that longer protective effect. And also, we're coming into summer, and there'll be less transmission in Australia relatively than a winter period. It's one of the reasons that Europe has got a problem at the moment. So I would say to people, just follow the recommendations. And at the moment, the recommendations are, if you're in a, you know, immunosuppressed, go and get your third shot because you don't have as good a response to the first two. If you're over the age of 60, you should be coming up to about 6 months already, get your third shot. But everybody else, probably wait till when your 6 months comes up, which will be March, April, which will give you a good position to have better protection for the next winter, which is our next biggest risk period for a lot of transmission occurring.
And just quickly, Professor, a big day on Monday, of course, with Queensland reopening to New South Wales, Victoria and the ACT. Is Queensland ready for this?
Well, it'd be better if they had higher levels of vaccination than they've got now, but they've got over 80% and it'll go up with time. So, look, you know, we're going to have to live with this virus for years to come. The biggest protection for us is vaccination, but it's also some restrictions if there's a lot of transmission. So once we get to the appropriate levels, and I think 80% is the level, better if it's 90%, we need to promote more vaccination, get more people vaccinated. But once we do that, and particularly over summer, where people are outside much, much more, yes, you should be able to do this safely. Yes, we'll get transmission, but we need to concentrate on hospital admissions as our endpoint to see what the effect is rather than cases. Because if you're vaccinated and get a case, you tend to have a very mild disease or even asymptomatic. So by focusing on cases rather than the consequences, such as hospital admission, we can get a false impression and give us fear and worry, I think, a bit needlessly.
OK, it's good focus. Professor Peter Collignon, we appreciate your time this morning. Thank you.
But first, let's bring in paediatrician Dr. Anthea Rhodes from the Royal Children's Hospital in Melbourne, who's just surveyed parents' response to the jab for 5 to 11-year-olds. Doctor, great to see you.
Good morning, Doctor. Thank you for your time. Australia is becoming, of course, one of just a handful of countries in the world to approve the COVID vaccine for children. What's your response to that?
Oh, good morning, Sylvia. Look, it's an incredibly exciting day today to have approval for our kids aged 5 to 11 to receive the Pfizer vaccine against COVID-19. And in our study, we learnt that one of the main things holding parents back was wanting to know more about the safety of the vaccine and particularly how those children receiving it overseas have responded. So now that we've got data on many millions of kids across the world safely having received this vaccine, we're excited for parents that they can be confident to go ahead and vaccinate their own children.
So were parents more likely to get vaccinated now they had this information?
Absolutely. So understandably, parents have questions about, you know, what's involved when it comes to vaccinating their child, and they really want to know that it is safe enough and works well enough for their child to go ahead and have the jab. And we have learnt from this study that knowing this information from those children around the world who've had the vaccine is the thing that parents really were waiting for to reinforce their confidence to go ahead. And the other really important thing that parents have told us, now that they're ready to get their child vaccinated, how they're going to do it and how and where they want to do it, with convenience, familiarity being top of mind when it comes to the planning.
We have very high childhood vaccination rates in this country. How do you see this playing out for us here in Australia with the COVID vaccine in children?
We expect that the vast majority of parents will be ready to go ahead and vaccinate their child. What we have to think about really carefully now is how we make that a positive experience for children and an easy experience for parents. So as the rollout is planned, government will need to really think about what works well for families. We have to remember that this is not the same as vaccinating adults or even teenagers. Younger children will need longer time periods to actually get vaccinated. We have to be really sensitive about doing that in a way that's not frightening for them, that's supportive, and that's easy for parents. Because we also have to remember that the first dose is just one of a series, and we're going to be looking for parents to come back in 8 weeks to line up for dose number 2 in the schedule, and potentially more doses down the track if they do go on to have boosters. So a positive and easy experience is going to be really important for families.
So now you've led a poll of parents, asking them about the vaccine. What were the findings from that poll?
So from that poll, we found that 62% of parents said that they would be more likely to go ahead and get their child vaccinated if it was available at their local GP. Just over half of parents said that they'd like to see a vaccine site available at their local school. So these sorts of convenience factors are important for families.
And any other interesting findings out of that survey?
One of the other really interesting findings was that just under half of parents told us they'd be more likely to vaccinate their child if they could get paid time off work. So we have to understand that for young children to be vaccinated, parents really need to be there with them to support them through that process. And for many parents, that will mean they might have to take some time off work. So there's an opportunity there to think about subsidies for parents to allow them to do that and not be financially compromised so they can actually go ahead and get that vaccination done.
Well, it's a fascinating study. Dr. Anthea Rhodes, we really do appreciate your time this morning. Thank you so much.